additional detail. So as we're going through this, I want you to be able to take lots of notes because I did not have any handouts prepared for you. I find that one of the values that you will get in today is learning how to listen to people and translate that into note form for yourself. And every time you get an opportunity to practice it, it enhances that skill for yourself. So you're going to do a lot of writing and translating. Likewise, if you have a question at any point during this presentation, I want you to feel free to raise your hand at that moment. We have a pretty tight time frame. There's only about a little more than 30 minutes left for our session. So I'm going to move through this information at a relatively quick pace. So if you have a question at that moment, raise your hand and ask it, because everything kind of builds on one another as we move through it, and we probably won't have a length of time at the end, right, for Q&A. Yeah.
Will you be willing to share your PowerPoint?
Yeah, I'm 100% willing to share the Prezi. I use this as a lot. I update it every once in a while, but it's a really good foundation. What we're going to cover today is what is topicality? It's a general introduction into the purpose of it. We will talk about what it means for the affirmative and what it means for the negative. So how to run it as a negative argument. And then also what your 2AC or member of the government speeches might look like in response to topicality. Okay. So just by show of hands, how many people have debated before? Okay, should be most of you, if not all of you. There's a couple of brand new folks. That's okay, right? So those of you that are brand new, you might have more questions. Like, say what? Who's a what? That is okay, right? Ask me, it's better to get an answer to it early. Hello, my name is Alexis. I'm a professor at City College of San Francisco. Prior to coaching there, I taught at San Francisco State and was the director of forensics there for 8 years. And prior to that, I was in a bunch of different schools, but once upon a time, I actually went to community college here at Santa Rosa Junior College. So getting to come back here is always really fun, because I get to come back to one of the places where I started or got to explore additional parts of my learning. And there's some just Santa Rosa students in here, so rock on. So today we're going to talk about topicality, and first I think it's important for us to get some framing about what topicality is on the purpose level. Topicality, I think, is best understood in the context of, I'm totally happy if you take photos.
Oh, you're not.
That is exactly what I want to know, is I don't want to be the photo. Okay, perfect. So, I think the first thing we have to think about and talk about when we're thinking about topicality is the resolution, right? The resolution, it doesn't matter what format of debate you are in, whether it's Lincoln Douglas, policy debate, or parliamentary debate, right? You'll always have a resolution. And the resolution sets out the topic area for us, right? Otherwise, it would be kind of infuriating if you didn't know what you were going to debate about, right? Every time you stepped into the round or every time you were trying to prepare for a debate. So you get a resolution. These are the LD, the NFA LD resolution, and the policy debate resolution for this year, which are the top two sections. And then these three are sort of sample parliamentary debate resolutions. And the reason I offer some samples is because it's different every debate, right? And these are ones that come from actual tournaments from the past 2 or 3 years, right, on either our regional or national parliamentary debate circuit. So one of the things I think is most important, and I've got these question marks floating around, is I think that all resolutions ask a question. All resolutions ask a question. In fact, they ask multiple questions. There's usually a central question, right, and then there are secondary questions. And you can often just take the resolution and just flip it into a question. So for example, this first one under a parliamentary debate, the United States federal government should ban the practice of mountaintop removal coal mining. This is where we, instead of like making mines into mountains, we just blow the whole thing up to avoid some of the problems with coal mines. There's obviously other problems with blowing mountains up. And so it's a controversial right, topic. And so to me, often the way you can just change this into a question is by taking the word should and putting it in the front of the sentence and then adding a question mark at the end. So should the United States federal government banned the practice of mountaintop removal coal mining. Should they do it? The affirmative in that debate will say, yes, they should do it. And the negative should say, no, they should not, or there should be an alternative way of doing it. Those of you that come to the counterplan lecture later today will hear me talk a lot about the relationship between topicality and counterplans. So this question, usually the central question, right, needs to be answered by the affirmative. That's why it's a stock issue, right, or a thing that the affirmative is supposed to do. It is also, right, really important for the negative so that they can prepare what they're going to talk about. If the affirmative came in and said, we're going to stop fracking for natural gas, right, you wouldn't be prepared to talk about it that, right? You'd be prepared to talk about mountaintop removal. And so the first question I think you should always ask yourself, whether you're affirmative or negative, when you get a resolution is, what is the central question here? What is the central question, and how can I answer that in a straightforward way or as straightforward as possible? So what is topicality? Topicality generally, or the general purpose, is to help determine the scope or the parameters of any given resolution, right? So that we know the limits of what we should be expected to prepare on the negative side of the debate, or what the limits of what we can prepare are on the affirmative side of the debate. And I like to use this little frame analogy to sort of discuss the difference between topical and non-topical affirmatives, which is often how this language gets deployed. So I think that the frame here, this cute little yellow frame or gold frame, that's like the resolution, right? It sets out a sort of an area, right, around which we will debate. And if we were to use this sample that I have offered, right, the sample resolution is the United States should limit the use of nuclear weapons. And we get a resolution that says that the United States should limit the use of nuclear weapons. There's actually a lot of different ways that we could do that. Right? We could change our use policy. We could change the places where they are located, maybe the number of nuclear weapons that we have out around the world. And so all of those topical interpretations, meaning reasonable interpretations of things like limit and nuclear weapons, would fall inside the frame. Right? All those topical affirmatives fall inside the frame. I think a good example of affirmative plan text or an affirmative plan action that will fall within the sample resolution is that the United States would adopt a no first use policy. This has been in the news for the past couple of weeks, actually. No first use policy just says that we won't shoot first. That we might use nuclear weapons in a retaliatory function, like if somebody attacks us first or uses their nuclear weapons first, but then we won't use them first. Right now we maintain a posture where we could pull the trigger first. Right? There's a bunch of benefits and disadvantages to a no first use policy, and that's the purpose of the debate. Right? Should we limit nuclear power? And then the second question is, how should we limit nuclear weapons or the use of nuclear weapons? So on the outside of the frame would be plan actions that don't fall within a reasonable interpretation of the resolution. And I will use this term a lot, reasonable interpretation. Right? What is a reasonable or perhaps particular interpretation of that original sentence, right, that would lead us to understand the plan action? An example of that that I put here is that the United States should close Guantanamo Bay. This might be a good idea, there might be a reason to do it, you might have tons of advantages, but it does not fall within the purview of limiting nuclear weapons, right? It is a non-topical affirmative for this particular resolution. Now, I think that it starts to get kind of tricky when we start looking at the frame itself. You'll notice I didn't just use a thin box, like a thin red line or yellow line to go around. It was actually a kind of thick frame. And that's because there's lots of arguments that are in here that are often related to the topic or affected by the topic, but are still ultimately not topical, okay? Or have different layers of topicality. So for example, I wrote here, the United States should stop making nuclear weapons. Plain text was, the United States should stop making nuclear weapons. Well, that might eventually have an effect on our ability to use nuclear weapons. Right? So there's kind of a causal effect that might take place later down the road, but we can't say for sure. Right? We can't say for sure. So we could say that it is related to the topic and might eventually affect it, but it's not a firmly topical plan. It wouldn't necessarily put the ending of production inside the frame. Does that make sense? Right. So when you're affirmative, you always want to have stuff that lands inside the frame, right, to have a fully topical affirmative. And when you're negative, you want the affirmative to be in there so that you know what to prepare. Right? And that is a huge component for the negative, right? It helps set up some predictable ground, right? So you can try to come up with some case arguments, right, or other kinds of link arguments that you might want to use later in the debate. Okay. So that's the general purpose, limit the scope of the recommendation, right? This I've already covered a little bit, right? But there's two specific purposes. One is so that the affirmative meets their burden of proof, right, or they meet their stock issue. Right? This is language that comes directly from the NFALD handbook. It is also used often in parliamentary debate, especially around policy-oriented solutions, which is mostly what I'm talking about today. And it's also a negative argument. Right? It's actually a whole off-case position, a procedural argument, that the negative can make in the debate, in the 1NC or in the leader of the opposition. The second component, though, that this is really fun to think about in terms of the negative, is it's also a strategy component. Sometimes there's a topical affirmative, like it fits within the resolution, but you want to get a specific kind of link story for your disadvantage, or for your criticism, or maybe even some kind of case turn. Topicality can be part of a much larger strategy in order to get the affirmative to concede something under the guise of topicality, but really what you're doing is you're getting a link argument for some other argument in the debate or some other position that you have in the debate. So for example, a really common term that gets used in debate is substantially. You're going to debate a lot of resolutions that say substantially increase or substantially decrease some phenomenon in the world, right? And you might run a topicality argument about the word substantial and have a pretty high threshold for it, right? You might say for something to be substantial, it has to be 80% of the original. It has to be 80% of the original. And the affirmative team might say, like, awesome, yes, we totally meet that. We are more than 80% of the original. Yes, we 100% of that, we are topical. And on the negative side of the debate, you are like, awesome, because you've got some sort of sweet link story that talks about what happens when we change things at 80%. Right? So it is a really good procedural tool for you to make sure that the affirmative fits within that frame, right, and is playing the game the way that they're supposed to. And for more advanced debaters, it becomes a complex part of your strategy in order to get a concession or get an argument on another piece of paper or on another position in the debate. And if that seems like a little too much strategy for you right now, that is okay. Right? That's totally okay. But you will start to see this play out as soon as you start debating, right? The way the arguments work together across the flows, right, or across the different positions. So let's talk about the different kinds of topicality arguments. There's actually three. The most popular and the most prevalent that you will encounter, especially in your first or second year of debate, is just non-topicality, right? That there are affirmatives that fit within the frame that are topical, and there are affirmatives that don't fit in the frame, they are not topical, right? So this is my Guantanamo Bay example. Right, Guantanamo Bay is not a way for us to limit our use of nuclear weapons. These are usually the easiest to identify because they may not even use the language of the original resolution. They may not use the right, the same actor, right, or the agent of the resolution, like the, say the Supreme Court, right, versus the Congress. Right? They may not talk about the same object. Right? So in this case, right, Guantanamo Bay is not an example of nuclear weapons. Right? And they may not take the same action. Right? I think it's helpful here to think about the direction of the action. Is it the resolution tell us to increase something or decrease something? Does the resolution say to widen something or to narrow something? Right? Are they taking the appropriate direction or action based on what the resolution mandates? There are two other kinds of topicality that you can both embed in a non-topical argument, or you can make as independent voting issues or independent topicality arguments if you like. They're extra topicality and effects topicality. So extra topicality is when a plan does something beyond the resolution, they do something more. And they can also do something that is within the frame or that would count as topical, but it's that addition of something else that makes them non-topical. They can add additional things on the edge of the frame, like this little guy up here, right? Or they can add things that are outside of the frame. Often these are plans or affirmatives that attempt to not just take multiple steps, but can get into multiple areas. Now the reason that this is really important, right, you might be wondering, like, who cares? If they're doing some topical stuff and some non-topical stuff, who cares? They're being topical, they're doing a little topical stuff. The reason that this is important, and then I'll get your question, the reason that this is important is because the negative gets to have everything else. If the affirmative decides to start cherry-picking arguments from outside the frame, they're basically stepping on the negative's toes. They're picking up arguments that the negative might have run and said, oh yeah, we're taking care of that. Oh, we're gonna take care of that too. Oh, and we're gonna take care of that as well. Functionally, like debunking or making it so that the negative can't run those arguments in order to be competitive in the debate. You're okay?
Yeah. But isn't that the point of the debate though? Like trying to have as much arguments as like the opposite, so they won't have to like...
That's a really good question. Right? I would not say that the point of debate is to always have more arguments than the other team. I would say that the point of debate is to answer that central question.
We go great about
right? Okay. And the affirmative answers it with a yes, and the negative answers it with a no. And then there's different strategies you can take to answer the question, right? Both on a content and on a structural level. So, the point of the affirmative is to find something inside this frame and test it and say, is a no first use policy the best way for us to limit our use of nuclear weapons? If you got up and you were like, let's implement a no first use policy and let's stop making nuclear weapons, like right on the frame right here, and let's pay off all the members of Congress who might disagree with us.
We're not debating one thing anymore.
Right? Yeah, now all of a sudden the negative has to be prepared for way more arguments. Yeah. One of the purposes of topicality is to make sure that the affirmative stays in their lane. Right? That they stay inside that frame and they make the arguments that they are supposed to be making to test the resolution, and that everything else gets to be for the negative, to kind of counterpoint not just the affirmative, but the resolution. Yeah.
Would the simple way to address that be to just say, like, you know, these arguments are off topic, off case, like I'm not...
Well, the first thing you should say is that it's extra topical, right? That your affirmative is extra topical. You're not just inside the frame, you're on the edge or using something from outside the frame. Okay. And actually make it a procedural argument as a reason why the affirmative should lose the debate. And I'm going to get to the structure of that in a second,
sure.
Right? But I would make it a full off-case position, right? A procedural argument, and use that make that a reason that the affirmative should lose the debate. Yeah. So extra T is adding things, The way I remember this is I think about, whenever I get tea, or get Starbucks or whatever, I get an extra tea bag. I get a double tea bag, right? So extra tea means there's multiple steps, or there's multiple tea bags, right, in my tea, or there's extra stuff that's gonna happen, not just what's in the frame. Effects topicality is a little different. There are some parts that overlap with extra tea, but it is its own distinct argument. So effects topicality is when the affirmative has to take multiple steps, and often steps that were not topical to begin with, in order to affect the topic area. Right? And so I've got that represented here with these red X's. So this is just a regular non-topical affirmative, right? I'm closing down Guantanamo Bay. It's all the way over here, it's nowhere near the frame, right? It's non-topical. These red X's, right, with these arrows, represent how an effects topicality plan, or an effectually topical plan, might operate. There might be one step out here, and that triggers some other kind of response in a topic area that's related to the topic, which might ultimately, over time or in the long run, do something about limiting our use of nuclear weapons, but does not do so directly. The affirmative's job is to directly affect the topic area. The negative gets to make arguments. For example, if let's say they had a counterplan about doing something outside of the frame that would eventually solve something in the frame, that's negative ground. The negative gets everything outside the frame. The affirmative gets the stuff inside the frame. So whenever you approach an affirmative, and they not only take multiple steps, because that could be extra tea, but they take these steps and it affects what's inside the frame only. That's an effectually topical argument.
So if they build their case from the bottom up, not from the top down?
Maybe. It's not always as simple as top and bottom, you know? I really think that thinking about causality is more important here, right? So I'll use one of the examples I used earlier. On the frame, I think is stopping the production of nuclear weapons. If we stopped producing nuclear weapons and over time had to retire our existing nuclear weapons, that would eventually limit our use of nuclear weapons, right? Because there just wouldn't be very many weapons for us to use. It would probably take a long time. And really, where you're starting is related to nuclear weapons, but not a direct limitation on the use of them. It wouldn't actually change the way that we use nuclear weapons right now. It would just change the number that are available in the future. I think that's a good example of an effectually topical affirmative, or somebody who would be linked to an effects topicality violation. So what does this look like? This is the structure of what the debate, of what the argument looks like in a debate. So this is what you would literally put into the 1NC if you're in LD or policy debate, or what you would put into the leader of the opposition constructive, which is the second speech in a parliamentary debate. Okay. There are four parts to every topicality violation. Okay. The first part is the definition, where you identify a key word or phrase from the resolution, and you define or interpret it. If you're in an evidence-based debate, you will define it with a piece of evidence. You will find a dictionary definition or a contextual definition from the literature base that you're working with that is related to the resolution, right, in order to define a word like substantial or nuclear weapons, or the United States government, if you want it, okay? So the first part is always a definition or interpretation. Often in parliamentary debate, it's a blend. Sometimes people will look up definitions before the debate, but usually it's an interpretation, right? Meaning a reasonable interpretation based on its context in the resolution, right? So the word limit, for example, generally means to constrain or to control. But to limit the use of something might be more specific, right? Or there might be a specific way that the word limit operates in the nuclear weapons literature, and you might bring that to the table. So that's number one, definitions or interpretations. The second argument is functionally your link argument. We call this a violation. When you are articulating the violation in a topicality argument or procedural, you are identifying the way or the multiple ways that the affirmative has not met your definition or interpretation of the resolution. Right? Yeah. Right? If you want to think about it, these are like the same four parts of a disadvantage. And the definition or interpretation is like your uniqueness, and the violation is like a link, right? Where you are identifying the way or the multiple ways that the affirmative does not meet the resolution based on your definition or interpretation. And again, you can do that based on what I talked about already. Are they taking the right action? Are they using the right agent? And are they looking at the right object of analysis or object of change? The third section is what we call standards. And sometimes you will hear this referred to as reasons to prefer. I like reasons to prefer because it really highlights that you're offering the reasons to prefer your interpretation of the debate. You are offering reasons to prefer your interpretation of debate. We are debating about debate at this point, right? About what we should be debating about and why. I'm gonna come back to the screen, so don't worry. These are some common standards that you will hear and should be using in your topicality debate. I've got listed five, there are more. And this is a good starting point. The first one is fairness. I think it's helpful to remember that we're playing a game. And like all games, there are rules to help ensure that there is fairness for all the players in the game, right? You would never play Monopoly with your family if you thought that every time somebody started as the shoe, that they had some sort of disadvantage compared to the person who was the top hat, right? You'd be like, no, Mom, I'm not gonna play. I'm always gonna lose. This game is very similar. There are lots of different checks on equity and fairness, and topicality is one of them. The questions that the standard asks about the interpretation are things like, does this interpretation produce a fair amount of clash? Right? And what other effects might it have on the quality of the debate? So is there a fair division of ground? Like, are there equal or at least a fair number of arguments for people to make on each side? Yeah.
Excuse me, would you have to know where the restroom is?
I do not. I think they're in the center.
Woo! Alrighty.
Okay, we have to go upstairs. Just stop. Okay. So, does it produce fair clash? Does it have a fair division of ground? Is it fair for the debaters in general? Right? And when I say it in all of this, I'm referring to the definition or the interpretation. Right? Is the definition or the interpretation fair for debate? The second standard that is often used is what we call field context. Field context is about who or where this term comes from and if it is appropriate for the topic at hand. I think a really good question that synthesizes this is this interpretation or definition from experts in the field of this topic? Are we interpreting it as it relates as a, you might hear this term as a term of art? Right, as a term of art for this particular issue. The third standard that I think is most popular and most relevant for you at the beginning of your debate career is education. Right? Do we learn anything about the topic using this interpretation or definition? And I think even more importantly, what do we learn about the topic? If the affirmative has approached the topic in such a way that it overlimits our ability to explore an area, right? We might be talking about nuclear weapons, but if we're only talking about this much of it and the frame was this big, the negative interpretation might actually be better for the education of the debaters as they learn about whatever the topic is in the resolution. The fourth standard that is perhaps one of the most popular is limit. Limits are really a good way of thinking about the edge of the frame. Who puts down the best edge of the frame? The negative's interpretation or the way that the affirmative has approached the resolution or the topic? Think about these like the parameters, right, or the limits on what we can talk about. All right, so think about the very, very edge of the frame. Some people want it to be really big. Some people think if we have a huge topic, that that's good for education, because we can learn about more things related to nuclear weapons, for example. Other people think we should have much more focused topics, so that we can really think about all of the specific issues related to use policies for nuclear weapons, rather than getting worried about the production of them or the way that they are being deployed or utilized right now. So the questions I put here are whose interpretation offers better limitations or parameters for the topic, and this depth over breadth argument, or breadth over depth, which should be preferred, a deep exploration of a small topic or a broad explanation of a big topic, right? Depth over breadth. The last one I put up here is grammar. This is fun for those of you who are interested in the kind of original context for the word or the resolution. So whose interpretation offers a more grammatically sound structure? People will try to interpret or define things in the resolution in all sorts of wacky and strange ways, right? So an argument you can use, or a standard that you can use to prefer your interpretation, is that yours actually meets the original intent of the resolution. Right? What did the author think when they were writing that resolution, or making that original argument, right, or crafting that topic for debate? You should have at least three standards for every topicality violation. I think three standards is a good starting point. Some people will have more, right? They might have like six standards or reasons to prefer. Right? It's up to you, but I really do think that two or three is a good starting point. So the fourth part of the initial structure of this argument are voting issues, right? Voting issues are just the reasons why the violation should justify a negative ballot or a vote, if you prefer, from the judge. Because that's what you're using this argument to do. You're saying, look, there was a central question in this resolution, should we limit the use of nuclear weapons? The affirmative did not answer that question, and they should lose the debate, right? They did not answer this question, and so they should lose the debate. There are a bunch of different voting issues. I have highlighted four, right? And they resonate or lock up with the standards I've already talked about. If you like the idea of thinking about this like a disadvantage, these are your impacts, right? These are your impacts. The first one is fairness. I feel like I've talked about this already a lot, right? But it's the idea of whether or not the affirmative's choices have limited either negative argument ground or their ability to approach the debate. And it's just not fair. There's no way the negative could have won, right? So they should lose the debate. The second one is jurisdiction, right? This is a legal term. You may have heard it or thought about it in the context of a legal courtroom. But just like those judges, right, if somebody introduces evidence that's not relevant to the case at hand, or makes arguments that are not appropriate for that particular case, the judge does not take it into evaluation. They don't take it into account. They're only supposed to evaluate the arguments that are relevant to or support the topic that they're exploring or the case that they're looking at. And the same thing is true here. If you make a jurisdiction voting issue, you're basically telling the judge, you're not allowed to vote on this app. This act doesn't fall within the frame. You only have jurisdiction, or you should only be voting for affirmatives that fall within that frame. The third one is, it's a stock issue. This happens a lot more in LD and a little bit in policy debate, sometimes in parley. I haven't seen it too much, but you can make this argument, right? But basically you're saying that the affirmative has not met their prima facie burden, right? That they have not met one of the core five stock issues that make them a valid or legitimate affirmative, right, for the debate. And then finally is education, right? That the affirmative has offered a less educational kind of mode or model, right, for debate, and that the negative interpretation would be preferable. It offers a better model for debate. Usually people have two voting issues. You could have one. Right, if all of your standards are an internal link to education, it's possible to just have one. I think it's a good idea to have one or two. If you don't tell the judge it's a voting issue, you are basically saying there's no impact to this argument, and it's not an offensive apartment anymore. Right? You have to have a voting issue for the judge to have something to vote on. You could win your definition, you could win your link violation, you could win your standards, but if you don't give them an impact to vote on, or you don't give them a specific voting issue to vote on, you'll probably not win the debate. Okay. So the last thing that I want to talk about, oh, I have a typo, it's not the MO, it's the MG, right? Are how you might answer a topicality argument, right? So this is in the 2AC in LDO policy debate and the member of the government speech in parliamentary debate. I've given you 7 options. There are more, and there are more nuanced ways of unpacking each one of these. The first thing that you always want to say is basically a no-link argument, right? Say that we meet their interpretation, right? We meet their interpretation. Our affirmative both fits within the frame of the resolution and their interpretation of the resolution. The second argument you want to make is an offensive argument. It's basically a link term, right? And this is a counter-interpretation. This is where you take a different interpretation or definition of the same word or phrase from the resolution and offer your own interpretation, right? So if they offer an interpretation of a limit, you can offer a counter interpretation of the word limit. And then we have a debate about what's called competing interpretations. Who has the better interpretation of the word limit, right? Or the US federal government, or whatever the debate is about. If you offer a counter interpretation, then you also need to offer or should offer counter standards. These are the same standards that I've already talked about, but there are ones that would support your interpretation of the debate. Okay. The third kind of argument that you might offer are flaws in the negative's interpretation. Right? This is like attacking their interpretations like generally or specifically the definition they've provided, whether it's a piece of evidence or it's a generic explanation. You'll hear this a lot, right? Number 4, that clash checks abuse, right? Clash is just a fun way or a debate way of talking about where arguments come together, right? We want clash in debate. That's why we do debate. We want to have arguments that respond to one another, right? Clash is ultimately good, right? When we say things like clash checks abuse, right? Basically what we're saying is when there's a lot of clash, when there's a lot of engagement in the debate, right? There are lots of opportunities for different arguments. If the negative got up and they made a bunch of arguments in the debate and topicality, but they also had like a disadvantage and a counterplan, and they had other substantive arguments that there was clash in the debate, regardless of your interpretation, you could say that proves that it's good for education, or that it was a good model for debate, right? Because it allows us to have a debate. You could also make an argument about the literature, right? That the way that this term or word operates as a term of art in the nuclear weapons literature, right, would actually be the most appropriate interpretation. Right? You might say that there's no proven abuse in the debate. This is kind of related to what I was talking about, clash. A lot of times, affirmatives will get up and say, prove it. Show me what you wanted to say that you didn't get to say in the debate. And if you can't prove that there's specific ground loss, if you can't prove that there are specific arguments you couldn't run, why should you win your topicality violation? Just because you have a good definition, and just because we didn't meet that definition, does not mean that it's the best definition for the debate, right? Make the negative prove what the harms are. Make them prove what exactly they couldn't do because of the way that you approach the debate. Okay? The last one, and I think this is arguably one of the most important and reiterative ones, is reasonability. Reasonability. You want to make the argument that either your counterinterpretation or your affirmative is a reasonable interpretation of the topic. If the negative overlimits the topic, or takes like a kind of new or different approach to defining a word, right? You should be able to look at the judge and say, look, we had 20 minutes to prepare. And in that 20 minutes, it was reasonable to interpret the word limit in the context of nuclear weapons to mean this, and that's why we developed this plan. Their interpretation is unreasonable. It is an unreasonable interpretation of the resolution that would ever force us to only talk about certain things, or actually force us out of the resolution in some way, shape, or form. There are more answers that you can make, and I would encourage you when you get back to your home squad to have mini tea debates.
Like what? Debates?
Mini tea debates.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, mini tea debates where you just debate about standards, right? Like education versus fairness, or predictability versus literature, right? One of the best ways to get comfortable with these arguments is just to do it. And you'll get to do it at tournaments, but having just topicality debates is one of the best ways to practice. Okay? All right, and that is our time. That was a lot of information in a short period of time. We don't have time for questions right now, right? But I'm happy to find you later. You should take out your schedules, figure out where you're supposed to go next.